Good afternoon, everybody. I'm so happy to see Dr. Umesh Bharti with us. And I would like to extend a warm welcome from our department on behalf of Gadwasu and with the IDP because he has agreed to give his talk today with us. And he is a very prestigious, he has got this very prestigious award. And that is the Padma Shri Award, and that is the I think the India's one of the most prestigious civilian awards. And the work which he has done, that is a pioneering work in the field of rabies. And I'm sure our children, our students, they will be getting so much from his talk. And what the protocol which he has made, and whatever he has done, his work he'll be sharing with you people. And his work on this disease, rabies, it has helped in the making changes in the WHO guidelines globally, right, on the use of these rabies immunoglobulins in the prophylaxis of rabies. And he is a core committee member for the National Action Plan for Rabies Elimination in India. He is also an expert member of the National Snake Bite Management Guidelines. Apart from that, Padma Shri Award, which he has got in 2019, he is also a recipient of the prestigious Louis Pasteur Oration Award, M.G. Alexander Oration Award in Tropical Infections. And many other awards, right? Like Dr. Tulsidas Chugh Award, then again, Satpal Mittal Appreciation Award, Nathan's Leadership Award. And there are so many awards which he has, got. And it is his dedication to which he has, reached this level. And we are honored, sir. So I would like to, request you to please start your presentation, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Deepti Narang and Gurungadev Veterinary and Animal Science University, Gadwasu. I am very thankful to all of you. So, see, we all talk of one health, and there are very little platform to interact with human health and animal health. So I think these opportunities are a golden beginning of the new era, where we are interacting with the both sides of health, whether it is human or animal. And I tell you, until there is a one health concept prevalent, and we work, we do not work, in collaboration with each other, we can't get complete health for human beings and for animals. So more and more such interactions are required, to learn from each other. And today's story that I am going to narrate is the perfect example, because we do experiments on animals, and then those experiments are replicated on human beings. But this story is such that we did some experiments on human beings, and when they all survived, 100% survived, then we replicated them on to bovine or animals. So this is a perfect example of how one health can work for each other's welfare and survival. So to begin with, let me. So you have to make me host so that I can share my screen, I think.
Okay.
Or you can make me co-host.
हेलो पूनम, वो स्पीकर है ना डॉक्टर उमेश भारती, उनको को होस्ट बना दो, उनका शेयर नहीं हो रहा।
होस्ट और को होस्ट व्हाटएवर।
हाँ जी,
अपने आप शेयर हो जाता है। और पूनम अपने आप शेयर
हो जाता है सर, हो जाता है अपने आप शेयर सर।
दीप्ति मैम को तो बनाई दो।
इसको
हो रहा है ना?
हाँ ये सर की स्क्रीन
ओके
तो आपकी स्क्रीन आ रही है
सर, आपकी स्क्रीन आ रही है सर।
आ रही है?
हाँ जी हाँ जी आ रही है सर।
पीपीटी
कैन यू सी माय
हाँ
प्रेजेंटेशन?
हाँ
ओके
हाँ यस सर।
वेरी नाइस। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस ए प्रोटोकॉल दैट वी हैव सीन 100% सर्वाइवल। इंट्राडर्मल रेबीज वैक्सीनेशन अलोंग विद लोकल वुंड इन्फिल्ट्रेशन ऑफ रेबीज इम्यूनोग्लोबुलिंस इन बोवाइन ए लाइफ सेविंग प्रोटोकॉल। सो वी आवर दी फोर पीपल me along with our veterinary friends Upinder Kumar and Dr. Darsh Kumar from Palampur, and the protocol was written by my wife, so she is also there. So let us, that's what the story is actually. If you see, we worked for 2 years only wound infiltration in human beings, because the WHO says that we have to give immunoglobulins as per the weight of the patient, and then calculate the amount of the immunoglobulin, give them into the wound, and give rest into the muscle, intramuscular. So what we came out with the new formula when there was a deficiency or a scarcity of immunoglobulin in the market and people started dying. So we said essential component is only wound infiltration, and we started only wound infiltration in human beings and saved many, many lives. 26 of them were bitten by lab confirmed rabid dogs. So this miracle protocol we published, and this publication was seen by WHO people, and they contacted me to know how we did all this and how people survived and what was the follow-up and everything, including data. Then they said this the 269 people are very few to take a global decision. So then they asked me to give them more data. Then we published another paper containing around 7,000 people who were given only wound infiltration, and they all survived. So even that was, no, still WHO people were indecisive to take a final decision, because it was a global decision, which is mostly not taken unless not taken based on one center study, and there's multi-centric studies are done in different continents of the world, and then the WHO takes a decision whenever they have to take a global decision. So this was going to be a history that only one center doing something, and then based on that some global decision was to be taken. So God was with our side and people were not convinced, but then we thought, when some people used to come to us that rabid cow or rabid buffalo, we have consumed milk and we should be given prophylaxis. So then I used to ask them whether that rabid cow or buffalo was given vaccination. They said yes, all the 5 doses, all the 3 doses, all the 4 doses were given before the cow or buffalo died. So that put a question mark in my mind that maybe the intramuscular vaccine that is being given to the cows and buffaloes is not effective. And then I learned that veterinary vaccines are 1 IU per ml. Rather, human vaccines are 2.5 IU per ml. So again, that strengthened the doubt in my mind that the vaccine given intramuscular to the bovine may be inferior, or may not be acting, or intramuscular mode may not be producing enough antibodies. So that's how we thought of doing something in bovine, and similar protocol that we have seen is 100% success in human beings were replicated in bovine by giving intradermal vaccine to bovine. Veterinary rabies vaccine, and giving local wound infiltration of rabies immunoglobulin into the wounds. So that's how we started doing this exercise. And when WHO people were double-minded, then this protocol was sent. This experiment and successful conduct of this experiment was sent to WHO by me, that 100% survival of all the cows and buffaloes after this protocol. So then they were very surprised, and then they were totally convinced that there is no base on calculating rabies immunoglobulin based on body weight, because we had a buffalo given 700 kg that was given 2 ml immunoglobulin only, and that's survived being bitten by lab confirmed rabid dog or mongoose. So that we come, so that's how the WHO, based on that final animal experiment, they you know, change the protocol globally. So that was a very moment of triumph for us. And now we'll see what we did actually. So these are the you can see the brain of a two and a half month old pup that was found to be rabid. And this is a Himalayan palm civet on the other side. Again, she was also found to be positive. So here another issue that I would not discuss much now is whether pups should be given vaccination below 3 months. Because we have 5 deaths in human beings that were bitten by pups below 3 months. So my sincere request would be to request all the veterinary people to make it a point whenever you bring a pup home, whether you bring it from a kennel. I have seen a person, a big landlord in Ludhiana who died of a pup bite, he bought from a kennel. So my request is that the WHO says, and there are experiments, there is separate presentation on that, that whenever you bring a pup home, get it vaccinated for rabies, then vaccinate the pup at 3 months and then vaccinate every year. And you would be surprised when people come to us and say, we have a dog fully vaccinated and should we take vaccination if the dog bites? Yes. Why? Still sometimes in 20 to 30% of the pups, there are not proper antibody type titers measuring 0.5 IU per ml of serum. So this is very important takeaway point, and that can be discussed separately. So why immunoglobulin is required? This is a very basic question that I want to again emphasize. You see, the vaccine takes 7 to 10 days to come to a level of 0.5 IU that are supposed to be protective. So that window period of 7 to 10 days is if the virus attaches with the nerve during that window period. So no amount of vaccine or immunoglobulin can save the animal or human beings. So that's how to bridge that gap of window period when the vaccine is giving response. We have nothing in the body to protect the people. We give immunoglobulins, ready-made antibodies to neutralize the virus at the wound site, because there is no viremia and the virus remains in the wound site. So that's how it miraculously neutralizes the virus in the wound site. You can see there are so many examples. Insulin syringe, we are giving into the wound site, into the scar. You can see we are all this being done in human beings. This was a lady bitten by a rabid dog. So she was saving her daughter and attacked by a rabid dog, and she was also attacked. And while she was roaming around in search of prophylaxis and especially rabies immunoglobulin, which were not available, so she came from Kullu to our clinic and we infiltrated the wounds. And when she went back, her cow had died because she was bitten by the same dog while fleeing from the house. So that is a perfect example or a human experiment or a biological experiment that local wound infiltration survives, and if we do nothing, then animals dies. Cattle are backbone of, we are from rural background. We have seen people cattle are the background, and entire family is run on the money that is earned from the cattle produce. And as I told you that when we heard that despite IM vaccination, the animal died. So that's why we thought replicating this human protocol onto the animals. That's how this idea started. You can see burden of cattle rabies in Asia has been estimated to be 5 per lakh. Exact burden of animal rabies in India is not known, as rabies in animals is not properly notified. There are no programs for preventive rabies vaccination of bovine in India, despite rabies in bovine being endemic. So the question was, can we save them on analogy of human PEP with IDRV and local wound infiltration of RIG? So that was a question, and that's how we drafted a protocol and we started doing this infiltration. So this is how 0.2 ml of vaccine was given into middle third of the neck. You can see the papule, 1 centimeter of raised papule. This is a horse being bitten by a rabid dog, being given local infiltration into the lip, into the lower lip. You can see with insulin syringe. This is a buffalo being given in, small puncture wounds on the muzzle, and this is the horse being given in local infiltration in the lower lip, and this is the dog. Many people may not have seen paralytic rabid dog, no. So that's why we captured this dog, drooling saliva and sitting quietly and just attacking somebody comes around. So we found that high titers were attained in majority of the domestic bovine with even single dose of 0.2 ml intradermal vaccination. So before we just to confirm that whether our route chosen is right, we vaccinated a buffalo with 0.2 ml intradermal rabies vaccine and took sample on day 14, sent to NIMHANS for titers, and the titers were 30 IU. That means 60 times higher than what were required. So I was surprised to see the response of the bovine to intradermal vaccination, which was huge. Subsequent responses were not vaccine dose dependent, but had desired protective level of antibody by day 14, even in animals having natural antibodies above 0.5 IU per ml on day zero. So while we were recruiting animals, we took day zero samples, and to our surprise, 40% of the cows and fellows were having already had antibodies to rabies without any vaccination. So you can imagine how much animals that are going around, roaming around, are having antibodies due to natural interaction with the, most probably with the carrier dogs or maybe rabid dogs. So that was very surprising. So it was difficult to carry on the experiment because they had natural antibodies. So we decided to recruit some of the animals having even natural antibodies in our experiment, because we are giving vaccination to animals in a natural natural way. Not we are not vaccinating only farm animals, but the rural people animal we are vaccinating. So let it have a natural way to vaccinate them, even if they have already have antibodies. So to cross check this phenomena, we in Palampur University we have a separate farm of animals. So we took blood samples from those animals, 12 animals, cows, and sent it for refit titers, and they were below the 0.5 cutoff limit. That shows that animals that are properly bred, they are kept in separate enclosures, are having antibodies less than 0.5, and those roaming around and having a company of dogs and other animals have antibodies higher than what is required. So this is a very strange phenomena that was encountered. So now we tested various schedule of intradermal rabies vaccination bovine and found that a schedule of 0.2 ml given in middle third of the neck on day 03, 7, 14, 28, like IM schedule, along with local wound infiltration of rig, is sufficiently immunogenic and life-saving in all of them, even if bitten by lab-confirmed rabies dogs. So that's how we started giving 0.1 ml on day zero only to some animals, do titers on day 14, then give 0.2 and 2 on day 03 to some animals, and then do the titer, then 037, then do the titer, then 037, 14, then do the titer, and then 03, 14, 28, and then do the titers. So we have all the details in our paper separately individualized, so that people can learn from that segregated data, because once we, it's a data play, once we accumulate everything, so sometimes the reality is not visible. And brain sample of suspected rabid animals, two dogs and two mongoose, those who have bitten on the animals were tested for rabies and found positive. So then we had a subgroup of animals. We had four animals that I think cows or buffaloes, that those were vaccinated by IM schedule. And as required as per WHO, they should have antibodies 0.5 IU per ml by day 14. But only one had antibodies slightly above the requirement, not like 60 times higher in intradermal route. So you can imagine that intramuscular route was not working with the same vaccine that was being given ID to the bovine. So that was again a very surprising finding that correlated that why the animals were dying despite being given IM vaccination by veterinary doctors. So many, so be detailed animals those were bitten by lab confirmed rabid dogs or mongoose, and they were given wound infiltration and ID vaccination, and all survived. Even we followed, even now they have survived. Many of them still we can follow. So what I want to say is similar experiment. Some of the people, some of the veterinary doctors learning from our this thing, our experiment, they were not knowing how to give ID vaccination. So they gave IM vaccination and wound infiltration of immunoglobulins, and those animals also survived. So that shows that the critical step is only wound infiltration of immunoglobulins into the wounds caused by dogs and mongoose. So that is the critical step. So ID, IM, though we have compared ID titers are high, very high than IM titers, but the survival was same when they infiltrated the wounds. The route may be ID or IM. So that is again a very important finding that I want to share with you. So the aim of RIG infiltration or injection into the wounds is to neutralize the rabies virus in situ and to prevent infection onset of rabies, as the course of anti-rabies vaccine takes about 10 to 14 days to provide full protection. Many recent expert consultation on rabies have opined that systemic injection of RIG is not useful, but this practice continued due to lack of any new scientific evidence. So that's how we created a new evidence, both in human beings and in bovine. So total of 62 animals were given 5 doses of ID post-exposure prophylaxis with 0.2 ml vaccine ID in the middle third of the neck, along with local wound infiltration of RIG, after their exposure to clinically or lab-confirmed rabid dogs or mongoose, and all had survived. The refit titers of 55% bovine in all groups were more than adequate by day after 1 year, and all had adequate anamnestic response by day 7 to a single 0.2 ml booster given at 1 year. So these all findings can now take us to draft a new protocol for post-exposure prophylaxis. Not only post-exposure prophylaxis, we also tried giving pre-exposure prophylaxis of 0.2 ml of vaccine given on day 0-3-7. And again, that was also found to be very, very immunogenic, having a anamnestic response on after 1 year, 2.2 ml of vaccine. So both post-exposure and pre-exposure protocol can be defined in this way. Serum sample from 15 animals bitten by lab-confirmed rabid dogs were collected on day 14 and tested for RVNA by refit from Nimas, Bangalore, and all had required antibody titers above 0.5 IU per ml by day 14, and all survived with this protocol. No immunosuppression was observed with the local RIG infiltration. As you see, the odd titers were very high. So as discussed, pre-exposure prophylaxis was found to be effective as 0.2 ml dose of vaccine on day 0-3-7, and all bovine had titers higher than desired by day 7 after single 0.2 ml vaccine booster at 1 year. So this is not a big study. So I would request like universities like you to, because our study points towards possibility of having short schedule of 3 shots of ID vaccination with or without local RIG infiltration as PEP and single shot ID as pre-exposure prophylaxis, but this requires further validation and further verification. This protocol of local RIG infiltration into wounds with intradermal vaccination have saved lives of bovine or even of equine. And we named this protocol in the honor of our beloved guru who died during this experimentation, Dr. Shampur Narayan Madhusudana from Nimas. So this was very unfortunate. The mentor died during all this exercise, and all load was on us to carry this forward. So now comes very interesting finding that I was discussing with you. You see, the buffalo having weighed 700 kg, bitten by rabid dog B in the neck and ear, given 2 ml of vaccine, and the titer on day 14 were 15 IU, which is, I would say, 30 times higher than required. You can imagine these titers were found among those animals also who already had antibodies. So there's a lot of discussion, like in pup vaccination, we should not vaccinate because they have already antibodies. No. So they have already antibodies, but still they were not boosted to that extent like naive animals, but they also showed response to the vaccine schedule. So So this is a paper that was published not in a very indexed journal, because you know something new. You know, people are very skeptical. Even editors are very skeptical because there are no other examples of doing such things. So we are thankful to Animal Ethical Committee of Palampur, Nimhas, CRI Kusoli, and obviously all my family members, because they were all. And for any clarification, this is what my address is, phone number is. You can call me, you can consult me anytime. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Very nice presentation. बच्चों आप लोगों को है कोई क्वेश्चन तो पूछो.
भाई थल्ले होएगा नहीं पता लग और लाल पे ओके ऑरेंज की वो बेकाय में
प्लीज म्यूट योरसेल्फ.
Dr. Bharti, is this procedure being followed now?
Sorry, sir.
Is this procedure being routinely followed in the field now?
Our experiment is known to now everybody in veterinary department in Himachal Pradesh. And recently, veterinary department purchased, I think, 60 or 70 vials of immunoglobulins for use. So okay. If people don't know how to do ID, because that otherwise that is the best way. So they even IM, when they are giving wound infiltration of immunoglobulins, even then there is a 100% survival. So I think critical, it's very critical for survival of the animals to give infiltration of immunoglobulin into the wounds.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I'm Mudit Chandra. Sir, it was a very good presentation. Sir, actually, from the student's point of view, means many students are watching and they've asked that what is the difference between intramuscular and intradermal, so that so much dramatic change has taken place in the body, so that the required 0.5 are you reached within 14 days, and it could not reach in intramuscular because you have subsequently also showed that some of the means in some of the animals it do reached. Second question they were asking also is, can it 40% immunity you are reporting to be there in stray cattle, those cattle which are intermingling with the local animals they might have encountered rabid animals, that is why this type of antibody development has taken place. So don't you think so this will be adding as a, because when we go more than 40% or 50 or 55 60% we can achieve a herd immunity, is it that stage which is happening in India?
Good questions. First, let me discuss IM and ID, because in human beings, this lot of discussion on IM ID, and then so many experiments were done, especially in Thailand, and now we have done in our in our country also, and we have done it. So we have clearly found now ID to be superior than IM, and we were surprised when we found this in bovine, including buffaloes. Because when we mooted the idea of giving ID to buffaloes or cows, some of the people laughed at us. No, so their dimag kharab gaya. 0.2 ml giving to a buffalo of 700 kg. So that appeared to be laughing stock. But still, we were very convinced that we should go ahead and do it. And then that's how we gave 0.2 ml to a buffalo and found the titers to be more than 60 times than required on day 14, just single shot of 0.2 ml. So difference is that we in skin, we have dendritic cells and then antigen presenting cells, and then in abundance in skin rather than in muscle. So that is a major difference that need to be studied by the students, that how these Langerhans cell and antigen presenting cell in skin do, because we are presenting vaccine antigen directly to those antigen presenting cells rather than in muscle, because then there is nothing that vaccine would go around through blood and then taken up by lymph nodes and other parts of the body. And I think that's the major difference, that ID is superior than the IM, especially in rabies vaccine. Other vaccines also have shown good results. But I would talk of, because we have done experimental rabies vaccine. Second thing, when we saw, when we were recruiting animals, you know, then we started taking 0-day antibodies so that to see that animals are not having neutralizing antibodies already. So then we were surprised to see that around 40 to 50,
your voice is not coming. Sir, your voice is not coming. He's not getting our voice also.
Ma'am, please call him. Please call him, ma'am, sir. Ma'am, please call him.
Okay, okay.
Reply to the question. See, intradermal has been always superior to intramuscular because we have in the skin we have antigen presenting cells and dendritic cells. So while in muscle we don't have in so many numbers, and in muscle the vaccine is diluted and it would go around in the blood and then to the lymph nodes and other so we are giving antigen directly to the dendritic cells. So that's how intradermal is superior. And I am very sure that in animals, this system must be very, very strong. That's giving such a robust response in to the vaccine in animals by giving intradermal route. So so that's how intradermal is superior than intramuscular. And the second question, giving herd immunity. So I gave recently I gave a detailed reply, but now I'll give a short reply. We discussed these antibodies with the NIMHANS and other experts. So number one, they may not be reflecting antibodies to true rabies virus. So that's how they may not be the true antibodies. They may be, similar antibodies that are reacting to refit test. So number one. Number two, even if they're true, this is very dangerous because if animal has lower immunity, they can cause rabies. So maybe we hear sometimes that our animals was not bitten by any dog or, still the animal is having rabies. So maybe these antibodies are not protecting them fully. That may be the reason, or they may not be true antibodies. So this is a question that needs further research.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful reply. Sir, one more question people are asking me. Sir, you are intended to change the number of days protocol also, are you?
Yes, like surely. My question is, if single shot of 0.2 ml given to buffalo gives us an antibody of 60 IU, so we need to experiment to shorten these protocols, and I'm very sure that we would be succeeding, but we need more experiments to do that and more numbers to conclude.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation, sir. Thank you very much.
That will be low cost also when you reduce the number of this doses, sir.
Sorry?
The cost will also be reduced, sir. Right?
Definitely.
Yes. Dr. C.K. Singh, sir, Dr. C.K. Singh is the head of the department of pathology. And sir, he is advisor to WHO for this devising rabies control strategies in Southeast Asia. So, sir, you want to speak, sir? Dr. C.K. Singh.
In fact, this particular assignment was a bit long ago. So presently, it is not like that. But and thank you for this wonderful introduction. I congratulate Dr. Amish. We have been meeting in various committee meetings and conferences. I congratulate you, Dr. Saab, for thinking out of the box and doing something which is not being told to, you know, follow it. People who toe a line, you know, that they do not end up creating something new. I'm reminded of when we did a MBSC study in our department, when groups of bovine species were given intradermals. So we were asked this question that this is not recommended in animals at all. So how can you do all this? So it is good that people start thinking out of the box and do good things. And that's how new things are found. And I fully agree that intradermal is really happening route of protecting our animals. And it did gave us good results in our studies as well. And Dr. Umesh has done a wonderful job. Regarding the discussion on the herd immunity kind of thing, because you know, it raises another question that do animals or can animals survive rabies virus like that in a herd? So that is another point. And antibodies and antigen antibody reaction is so specific that anything which is antibodies against rabies virus has to be a very true antibody. I feel that maybe if it is studied in a different parameters, we may come to the conclusion that you have already, Dr. Mesh is also pointing out that it could be something else. And I would also feel that we have something stumbled into something else. The herd immunity thing is not really happening in a quite a. And another thing regarding shortening of the schedule of vaccination, that is always on. Dr. Amish, I would like that you please press it further, because this corporate lobby is doing all things and agencies are helping shorter route would be much shorter dosage would be very helpful in protecting, but it is some other interests that longer duration and more number of doses are given. Already shots have been decreased by WHO, but lot many can be decreased. And intradermal route, as you know, in this effort of controlling rabies by 2030, probably Dr. Umesh was also in the same committee meeting when we were there in the department, this Ministry of Health in New Delhi. And nobody took this route, and they continued to harp around the intramuscular route for dog vaccination, though we tried to impress upon that it should be explored, that intradermal can be a lot helpful, as Dr. Deepthi rightly pointed out, that it will really at that colossal stage, if we are giving millions of dosages and attending so many uncounted number of stray dogs and other dogs, and intradermal should be the thing, and more even the bait vaccine, oral bait vaccination should be the thing, but they continued with the intramuscular, which is impractical in stray dog population scenario. But all in all, this was a wonderful out-of-the-box effort by Dr. Umesh, and I personally congratulate and for him for doing this job and sparing his time for today's lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. C.P. Singh. Thank you very much. I tell you now, now attention of the people are now ID vaccination, and there are some studies that have come out that in dogs we can do ID vaccination. I would share one paper to with Dr. Deepthi, and your university can play a big role in, you know, exploring these new routes of vaccination, and then, you know, giving thesis to children or maybe PhD thesis, because these are not small things to done. It takes long time and, you know, lab support. Thank you. Hello.
Are there any questions now? Thank you, sir. We don't have any more questions.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
No, right, sir.
Okay. Sir, we would like to extend our sincere thanks to Dr. Umesh Bhati for his excellent and very informative talk on intradermal vaccination of rabies with local wound infiltration of immunoglobulins. And he could spare his valuable time for the webinar. I would also like to thank IDP for giving us opportunity to our department to conduct such an informative webinar. And also, I think the information must have updated our students. Both UG and PG and PhD students were attending the webinar. They must have been updated with the information. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much again for giving me this opportunity. Thanks
thank
a lot.
You,
I hope
thank
that
you,
some
sir.
Message will go and further collaborate on these issues.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for sparing so much valuable time. I mean, from your such a busy schedule, at least you could spare some time for us, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank
you. Okay, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Bye.